with a great pleasure that I will share this panel session on connected devices and data. My name is Bruno Aiglan. I'm head of research and development at the Data Innovation Lab at AXA. When preparing this session, we were all very excited about the great panel of speakers that we gathered. They have a strong background in research, entrepreneurship, data science, and data engineering. And they are leaders in enterprises that cover several positions in the IoT value chain. So do not hesitate to ask some questions at the end of each talk and during the round panel that will follow the talks. Four of them, and welcome again. We'll start with Thomas Serval. Thomas is an iconic figure in the world of Internet of Things for lifestyle. He anticipated the trend and holds more than 15 patents in the field. He founded and led Barracuda, a world leader in Bluetooth technologies. And he was a CEO of Barracuda during 8 years. He then joined Microsoft France as a member of the executive committee and innovation director. And after this, he took on the role of managing director of innovation activities at Google. Recently, he founded Aleph One, an accelerator and incubator dedicated to communicating objects and big data. Welcome, Thomas.
Thank you very much. So I know most of you are very interested in very sophisticated data science, and I'm going to talk about very stupid stuff that are connected to your daily life. But what I would like to try to do in this presentation is to show you that the most simple acts, if you add data and services into them, they can, and the most simple devices, can be rethought or can change dramatically in terms of business model. So Aleph One is an accelerator dedicated to connected objects and big data with a very, very strong focus on insurance. That locates where you are in your mouth, and we'll see, I'm going to switch to the data science part because there is actually a lot of data science in it. So I'm actually able to locate where you are in your mouth and to check if you are doing this two times a day, 2 minutes. We took these 2 minutes and we make this a variable because since there is no science, we want to keep some room for debate in the data community. And so we actually are building right now the first useful data sets that connects the behavior of the users in their daily data hygiene or care hygiene, and the results, which is seen either as the damages that mutual insurance or health insurance has to pay back to the dentist, or actually the dentists themselves that are part of our programs. And so our first customer is, as you can imagine, the largest dental insurer in the world called Delta Dental, that saw this as a real breakthrough innovation, and we're working with them in making this a better product. So, I'm really confident. Another learning is education. So one of the things that you can do with data is actually to help people improve. So you can check whether they are doing or not, but you can actually help them and connect the data you're collecting into a better behavior. So one of the things that we also learned from the data we collected is one of the biggest needs was actually to help people improve. And the definition of improvement is actually not defined because there is no perfect version. So it's like someone shows you the best way for you, and then we measure the distance between the best way for you and what we actually are able to collect. So just a few numbers that are irrelevant to you in most cases, but we sell every day, every year, as many toothbrushes as cell phones. And France is very late behind lots of developing countries in terms of equipment of electric toothbrushes. So that's basically what we built, and I'm going to deep dive into a few aspects of the device. So the first thing that you want to do is to drive engagement, because there is no efficient data collection if you actually don't make it fun to use it every day. Otherwise, whatever data you will have is actually a very, very wrong data set. So the first thing we design in the device is actually something that will make kids come back to the game. So we invented and we gamified the experience. So we turned this into a so every brushing movement is actually part of a quest from this little parrot. I'm going to try to use the no. Okay. So we built an algorithm. I'm going to talk about that in a minute. That locates with you where you are in your mouth, and then you are able to collect coins and then get rewards. But not only can we do that, is we build a technology that is even able, after a few brushing, to locate the missing part of your brushing. So there are two kind of issues. One is overbrushing, which is usually done in the finance industry and consulting industry. People overbrush, they are a little too detail oriented. So that's even we don't brush enough. So on average, our measurements show that most people declare they are brushing their teeth from 1 to 2 minutes. In reality, they do 30 to 45 seconds. So there's a very, very strong disconnect between perception and reality here. With our device, we actually tested the engagement. And so we moved the average of a very well-known brand from 1 minute 07 of brushing to 2 minutes. And even we have to prevent the kids from brushing more because they keep playing the game. So once we have that, we build an algorithm that was able to locate where you are in your mouth. So how do you build an algorithm that locates you when you are in your mouth? When you have motion sensors. So for those of you who remember the physics classes, if I only have acceleration, gyroscopes, magnetometer, it's going to be quite kind of hard to actually have an absolute position. It's actually there is a natural drift in the current accelerometer that have been sold on the market today, so the accelerometer you find in your cell phone, and the margin of error is 25 meters. So from a TIS perspective, it's kind of very, very unusual and very hard to find a solution. So what we built is we used some machine learning. So we were lucky because your hands can have mechanics that are kind of easy to model, and your mouth and teeth are actually quite predictable. Well, you actually usually have from 0 to 32, and the distance and the movement, mechanical movement you can do. So we have a set of constraints that help us start building a deterministic model. Once we add a deterministic model, there is a lot of people that are brushing their teeth differently. So we had actually to build some classification and then to teach the machine what a good brushing was and what not a good brushing was. So we narrowed down the 25 meter to a 1 centimeter error. And so the funny part here is actually the thing we built here to locate where you are in your mouth is even closer from quantum physics than mechanical physics, because we don't know where you are, we actually have a probability of presence at some point. But since the cavity is actually a recurring mist at the same place for several weeks, it doesn't matter in our case. So that's actually an interesting way while you collect a lot of data that are going to improve globally oral hygiene, then narrowing down to actually be able to give you this kind of feedback. And of course, that has a great application. So here you see what we have in our SDK is actually we provide game developer a way to locate the mouth and to analyze the movement. So we actually detect 16 areas of your mouth and 38 movements. And so if you are a game developer, you can develop games based on the Colibri to brush the same way a Wii would be a video game console. So we are kind of a Wii for the bathroom. The other parts that I'm pretty sure are even more interesting to you is how do we collect the data, how do we handle them. So the very, very big issue if you're in the healthcare business is actually what kind of data set are you manipulating, and who is allowed to do what with which data. So the first golden rule, being based in France, the first golden rule we established is US data stays in the US, French data stays in France. Super important, because if you lose the trust of your user, you're dead. The other thing is that there are two sets of data, personal data which are not now really medical data, but will be in the near future re-labeled as medical data, because the global trend of the European government is to even be more protective to personal data, especially with regard to health. And there is anonymized data that are used to improve our models. And so our platform is actually built in such a way that data scientists can have access to our data sets without providing any personal data. And so we started having insurers that wanted to work with us. So our biggest question was actually, since the data are of the users, what kind of middle ground can we build that would be of interest to the insurer and that would be acceptable to share for the end user? And that's also a problem we decided to solve with traditional actuarial or statistical techniques. So we built a score. We call this a Colibri index. Think about this as a behavioral score. Basically, are you brushing your teeth regularly at every place, every day, twice a day? And as far as the insurance is concerned, your personal data is not as interested as which cluster or which category of brushery are you, because you are looking for classes of risk. So there are two sets of risks: the risk that is based on your genetics, food. So those risks we don't even share with anyone and we don't want to know. And there are the ones you really control. So think about the device as exactly the same way you are using a GPS tracker now to change the insurance, cost of an insurance. So we built this Colibri index, and what we found is actually the user was actually quite interested in being able to drive this Colibri index. Think again like a golf index where you play regularly and you train yourself as you get your number, your handicap or your index is low, and you have enough information that are valuable for the insurer to actually discriminate. So now what we are trying to do is to prove that if someone falls in this category in terms of behavior, then it falls also into the category in terms of risk. And we have very encouraging results that we haven't published yet on this first on the first attempt. I think that's basically what I was going to say. And so I built this, it's available for sale. And I built this for my own kit, so you can actually see the three co-inventors with me of this device. Thank you very much.